So just want to look at some verses in John chapter 6 for a few minutes. There's a question here that I want us to look at. What shall we do that we may work the works of God? After feeding the 5,000, Jesus walks across the sea, and some of the people follow Jesus across the sea the next day. And the core verses we're looking at are these two in John chapter 6, verses 28 and 29, though we'll look at some others around that. But these are the verses that have the question and Jesus' response to them. When they caught up to Jesus, then they said to him, "What shall we do that we may work the works of God?" And Jesus answered and said to them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent." So the question sounds pretty good initially, you know, especially when you take it totally out of context like this, you know, how can we do the works of God? It sounds like a good question on the simplest, superficial surface of it. It sounds like they want to follow Jesus and do what he's doing. And Jesus gives them a simple answer: trust in me. You know, Jesus is the one sent by God, and the verb there for sent is the same. It's the verb form of the same word that is we get apostle from. And apostle just means messenger or the one sent or representative of. So the Lord's answer is, trust me, the one that has been sent by God. Jesus is representing God. Now, I want us to look at a little more of this exchange so we get more of the context. If you look at verses 25 through 31, "And when they found him on the other side of the sea," remember he had crossed the sea and they were going to find him, "they said to him, 'Rabbi, when did you come here?' Jesus answered them and said, 'Most assuredly, I say to you, you seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal on him.'" So Jesus knows their hearts. He knows what they're seeking after. They're only seeking more food from him. So they're following him, pursuing him for the wrong reason. In verse 28, "Then they said to him," and this was our question, "'What shall we do that we may work the works of God?'" So based on what Jesus just said, they're basically asking him, how can we make this food the way you do? How can we do that miracle, that miraculous food, right? And Jesus answered them and said to them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent." Therefore, they said to him, "What sign will you perform then, that we may see it and believe you? What work will you do? Our fathers ate the manna in the desert, as it is written, 'He gave them bread from heaven to eat.'" So as you can see, they're still pursuing Jesus for food, for physical food, or if he could teach them how to create food the way he did when he fed the 5,000. They're still not following him for the right reasons. They're not trusting him. They're trusting in food. It's like if we go to God and say, "Help me win the lottery. If you'll just let me win the lottery, I'll have all I ever need," right? Well, what are we really trusting in? We're trusting in money, right? That's not the right thing. And here they're going to him, trying to get more food from him. They're trusting in the wrong thing. They're trusting in the food. So when his answer didn't involve feeding them, they asked for further signs, and you notice they're kind of manipulative. They point him to, "Hey, you know, our fathers were given manna in the wilderness. Can't you give us a sign like that?" That's what they're really asking for. They're asking for him again. They're trying to manipulate him and point him to doing that. So their whole question, their whole line of thought, the reason they were chasing the Lord was wrong. And they thought, and maybe they really believed to some degree that being able to make food like that was doing the works of God. But they were seeing that in a wrong way, in a very superficial way. And Jesus was trying to point them to himself, right? He's pointing them to the true bread of life. It's understandable. We need food. We need to be able to eat and survive. But he's trying to point them to what they need even more than just regular food. Eternal life only comes from Jesus. And this is what they should have been seeking, but they were carnal and they were only seeking that physical, that mundane food. They were missing out on the greatest blessing of all that they could have had, to know him personally and to put their trust in him and to truly follow him. They had an opportunity that none of us have because we're not present there with him at that time, right? So they were missing out on this great blessing, and it just kind of made me wonder, you know, why are we seeking the Lord? Are we seeking the Lord incorrectly, especially maybe sometimes? I know I gave kind of a silly example with the lottery, but are we maybe pursuing the Lord for the wrong reasons? You know, some people do promote, they promote God for the purpose of wealth and all these other things, houses and jets and cars. You know, is that the things we're seeking, these temporary things? There's other temporary things in life too, but all these mundane things will not get us into heaven. The desire for these things will drag us into hell though. So we want to be very aware of that. We want to seek Jesus, to know him, to follow him, to do the works he truly did, the important things. The Lord wants us to take the time to get to know him more than offerings of gold and silver. Time is our most precious resource, and spending time in his word, learning from him, that is the offering he really wants from us. God desires us to be merciful to others, helping them in kindness, and that is the sacrifice that we should be giving in Jesus' name. As a representative of the Lord on this earth, and you know, that's how we shine his light in this world. And that's how we bring others to Christ in baptism. So do not be deceived by material things, the temporary things of this life. Don't get caught up in those desires for those things. One day, all those material things are going to be wiped away, every one of them. One day, darkness and evil will end as well. All these things will be wiped away. All those will be done. Those people who lust for wealth and power, they will all be gone. We don't want to be caught up in those groups. We don't want to be caught up with them. So aim for the better, more precious, eternal things, a relationship with the Lord, to know God and to share that love and kindness and mercy. If there's anything we can do for you this evening to help you, if there's anything that we could pray with you about or anything of that nature, please do let us know either now or after we sing. If you want to talk to someone privately, that's fine too. Just let us know. We're going to sing this invitation song 303, Whiter Than Snow.